Okay, pop quiz time. Two words that I've never said on a chalk talk. Yep, you're right. It's thermal grease. I know, all of you were thinking exactly that, right? Yep, this series is going on 14 years old, y'all, and I have not once said the words thermal grease. Well, until today, that is. Maybe you're like me and you know very little about thermal grease. Or maybe you know enough about it to know that there has got to be a better way. Or maybe you just thought it was some kind of cooking accelerant. Either way. Well, my thermal grease information-seeking friends, you've come to the right place. Hi, I'm Amelia Dalton, host of Chalk Talk. Today, we are delving into the world of thermal management with Len Metzger from Panasonic. Len and I discuss the details of thermal grease, its drawbacks and unique design considerations, and most importantly, its alternatives. And before we get started, don't forget to click that link. There you can find even more information about thermal management solutions from Panasonic. Hi, Len. Thank you so much for joining me.
Hi, Amelia.
Okay, so we are here today to talk about alternatives to thermal grease. But let's start with thermal grease itself. Why would I want to use it?
Well, for one, it's a low-cost solution. It's widely accepted in the industry, and it's relatively easy to apply.
And if I'm using thermal grease, what are my options there?
Well, there are a couple of different kinds of thermal grease. Some are metal-based with metallic particles inside, and grease is, you know, ceramic-based. They're relatively easy to apply and widely accepted in the industry. They also have pretty good thermal performance.
Okay, but what are the drawbacks to using thermal grease?
Well, grease can be messy to apply. A lot of manufacturing operations don't really care for using it because it is messy. Many of the greases contain silane, which is bad for the environment as well. Thermal grease can harden, it can leak out. When you're putting grease between two dissimilar materials that have different coefficients of thermal expansion, you can actually see a pumping effect where the grease gets pumped out and you lose some. And that, if it's metal-based, can get on the circuitry and cause problems there.
So thinking about all of that, what are my design considerations with thermal grease?
Well, the life in the application. You really want something that's stable. And grease is not all that stable. It can require maintenance, especially in applications where they're kind of inaccessible, like in high bay lighting, where you'd have to send somebody up on a lift or a ladder. You really don't want to go up there, and you want the system to operate on its own. Also, it tends to require inspections for the reasons I just mentioned. So you have additional expenses besides the initial outlay for the product itself in terms of the inspections. If you have something that's more stable, you wouldn't have to do that.
So what are the alternatives if I don't want to use thermal grease?
Well, Panasonic has a number of solutions in the thermal area. We started out with our pyrolytic graphite sheet, which is a heat spreader, and we call it PGS for short. We also have what we call PGS plus semi-sealing material, or SSM, which is an elastomer that's used with PGS behind it. Then, skipping to an insulator, we have what we call NASBIS, which stands for Nano Silica Balloon Insulating System, or sheet. That's kind of the opposite of PGS. Rather than spreading heat, it's an insulator. And in fact, it's a better insulator than air, which is a very good insulator itself. We also have a graphite pad, which conducts heat perpendicular to the sheet, or in the Z direction. Lastly, we have what we call a graphite TIM, or thermal interface material, which is a compressible form of PGS with low thermal resistance. It's kind of a spongy material.
Let's start talking about PGS.
Okay, well, looking at PGS compared to grease, grease is a rather low thermal resistance product. PGS, though, needs to be used with some pressure to achieve really good thermal contact. You'll see that when pressure is applied, thermal resistance goes down. Not so much for the grease, more so for the PGS. And also in this graph, you see different thicknesses of PGS. Relating to the thicknesses of PGS, the thermal conductivity of the thinner sheets is better. But with a thinner sheet, it's kind of like a narrower pipe with water. Your pressure is higher, but you can't move as much water with a narrower pipe. Similarly with PGS and a thinner sheet, the thermal conductivity is good, but the heat transport is limited. So there, like with anything, there are trade-offs.
So Len, what if I have a PCB with small surface mount components and I need to do some cooling?
Okay, well, for that, we have the semi-sealing material, or SSM, with PGS. So that elastomer is kind of like a white foamy material. And by applying it with some heat and pressure to a printed circuit board with small surface mount components, it kind of acts like a conformal coating. And it eliminates the air gaps and actually leaves the impressions of the components in the elastomer. So by eliminating air gaps, you're getting better thermal transport. While the elastomer isn't that thermally conductive, once it gets into the elastomer and gets to the PGS material, the PGS spreads it out quickly. With the SSM on the printed circuit board, it kind of averages the temperature over the area covered.
Okay, but what about insulating?
For insulating, we have the NASBIS product, and that is actually a better insulator than air. An example where you might use that is if you don't want a hot spot, like on a piece of consumer electronics that's pressed up against someone's face, you wouldn't want a hot spot there. So you want to put the insulator in to block the hot spot, and then if you need to channel that heat away, you can use a layer of PGS behind that to spread the heat to a heat sink.
What if I want to send the heat directly back to the heat sink rather than spreading it out?
Okay, for that kind of application, we have our graphite pad. That conducts perpendicular to the sheet or in the Z direction. We make that in a liquid silicone base, and we take shavings or flakes of the graphite sheet material and embed that in the silicone, in the liquid silicone. Then we subject that to a high magnetic field that orients those flakes in the Z direction. Both the plain PGS material and the graphite pad are also electrically conductive. So if you need electrical isolation for the graphite sheet, we have laminations of different materials, whether it be some acrylic tape or adhesive, and also some higher temperature tapes that can be laminated to the PGS and are available in standard sheets. The graphite pad is electrically conductive and it operates on its own, so that might be an issue if you need insulation.
So this needs to be used under pressure, right?
Yes, generally speaking, pressure is needed to establish good thermal contact in any of these situations. Your performance would not be as good without the pressure.
So this seems like it would be really stable as opposed to the grease.
Yes, it is. It's essentially carbon, which kind of leads me into the way we make the graphite sheet to start with. We start with a sheet of polyamide plastic. It's fired at a high temperature, over 1,000 degrees C, and then that eliminates the volatile organics in the plastic and basically converts that plastic into carbon. Then we do a second higher temperature firing, which establishes the graphite structure. So what we get is layer upon layer at the molecular level of a carbon ring array structure. So it's the hexagonal carbon ring array, and that's what gives us the thermal performance in the plane of the sheet. Now, the individual molecular layers are held together only by van der Waals forces, so the thermal conductivity in the Z direction for the plain graphite sheet is not that great. But the material is thin, and once you get the heat in there, it spreads quickly. The graphite TIM is a form of graphite. It's essentially carbon. There's really nothing to wear out in it, unlike grease, which can dry or leak out. So it's very stable.
Earlier, you mentioned the pump out problem.
Yes.
Would we be seeing this here as well?
Right. Well, you would not see any pump out with the graphite TIM. It's just kind of compresses like a sponge. But the thermal grease, when you have the different coefficients of thermal expansion operating on the grease, especially in temperature cycling, you can get a pump out effect where you're actually pumping out some of that grease. A, you're losing the grease from the application, and B, you also might get it on the circuit.
So, Len, am I going to have to buy a sheet of this stuff to use it in one of my designs?
Well, you certainly could, but in the case of the graphite TIM, we also have a whole series of part numbers cut to common industry IGBT footprints with the holes in place. So really all you have to do is put it in place and bolt it down.
So how does graphite TIM compare with regular PGS?
The big difference there is A, the thickness, and B, the compressibility. Regular PGS is not compressible. The graphite TIM is. So if you picture a sponge and put it between two uneven surfaces under pressure, you're eliminating the air gaps using the compressible material, whereas an uncompressible material might still leave some gaps if the material has an irregular surface. So being that it's compressible, you can achieve a tight seal with once it's compressed where it needs to be in the application and eliminating the air gaps, which are detrimental to the heat transport.
So what designs do you see this being ideal for?
Well, it's kind of, you know, limited only by the imagination of the engineer, because often we'll talk to customers and people will come up with ideas that we never even thought of. But typical applications would be in LED lighting where there's heat and you need to get rid of it. Graphite sheet, for one, can spread the heat, but at the end of the day, you're going to need to get rid of the heat. Also in power modules, the more inefficient they are, the more heat is going to be generated. And with switching frequencies increasing as they are today, heat is going to become more and more of an issue. So we have a number of different products to address that.
So you've got a lot of applications listed here. I imagine sometimes different solutions are going to be necessary.
Right. It really depends on what needs to be achieved. As I said, we can bring a number of different products to bear depending on the application. If the heat needs to be spread to a heat sink, we can do that. Also, by sandwiching it in between the heat source processor IC and a heat sink, by spreading out the heat, you're bringing more of the heat sink into play and making the heat sink more efficient. So in some applications, as I said, you just need to go between a heat source and a heat sink, and the gap is not so important. You just have a tight space and you're clamping it all together. But in some applications, you might need to fill a gap. In that case, the graphite pad can be a solution, or the semi-sealing material. But solutions can also be customized for specific applications.
Okay, cool. Can we get into some details about what graphite TIM buys me for my next design?
Well, lack of maintenance, reliability, and it can be compressed, so it fills the air gap. The key thing is the reliability of, once it's in place, it's going to stay there and really no life issue on it.
What about the advantages of the graphite pad?
The graphite pad, because of its construction, operates perpendicular to the sheet direction or Z direction, so it quickly transfers the heat from the source to a heat sink directly, going back directly as opposed to spreading it out and using that approach.
Well, I think that's all I have time for today. Thank you so much for joining me, Len.
Thank you, and really appreciate it.
And before we go, you didn't forget to click that link, did you? There you can find even more information about thermal management solutions from Panasonic. For Chalk Talks, I'm Amelia Dalton from eejournal.com. For more Chalk Talks, head on over to the Chalk Talk section of EE Journal. You can't miss it. It's right across the top. Or head on over to YouTube, youtube.com/EEJournal.